We're going to investigate this heptagon. There are seven sides to a heptagon. Inside the center of this heptagon is turmoil. It's the daily course of one's week. Outside the heptagon, in each one of the corners, there are seven circles. One circle is larger than the other. God's only asked for one day to set aside. Once you got to know God, you'd want him to be with you every day. Stay tuned.
You are listening to whitehorse-radio.com. The seal has been opened. The writer has been chosen. The blockheads insulted the Creator at the beginning of time. They went so far as to try and hide it over the course of 400 years. So God hid something at the end of time. This man knew what was needed in the beginning. It is time to wrap it all up. Here is your host, Brother Abel.
I don't like the idea that I have a big brother, a government agency watching over me. I'd much rather have God, because I think God is less intrusive. God is more forgiving, more loving, more kind, more merciful than a government is. A government's always looking for ways to try and cut the budget, looking for ways to eliminate the masses in order to keep the balance. God has set aside, out of 365 days, he's set aside 49 of them. He's asked for 49 days. 7 times 7 is 49. And the Lord is loving. He wants people to know and understand his word so that you'll understand what you're involved in here, what's going on in the world. There's only one book that tells us God's entire plan for his kingdom and for how man is to operate here on the earth. But we've come to the end of the day, the end of days. The enemy said you did not need to worship the Son of God in order to have peace. That's what he said. He said you didn't need, you know, the Son was unnecessary. Sadly enough that he didn't believe that the Son was real, as many of the angels didn't believe that the Son was real. We serve one God who has revealed himself in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. One God revealed in three persons. When we take a look at this passage in Colossians, and we read this, Colossians 2, 6 through 23, we find a lot of this truth right in there. But it also says in Colossians 2:16, it says, "Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day, or the new moon, or the Sabbath days, to judge you concerning on that day." God asked one day, set aside to understand him and spend time with your family. Get to know him. Man was not made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for man, a day of rest. In resting, you could meditate on the Word of God, to know God's Word, to know him, to get understanding his personality, who he is, so that you would not have fear in walking with him day by day. See, fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Once you feared judgment, once you feared the wrath of that God will not allow sin in his presence, and you start dealing with that sin and start walking in his light as he is in the light, you'll have fellowship one with the other. You begin to want to have more relationship with him, more and more and more. Walking with God, not just one day a week. You'll walk with God every day of the week. He'll help you through. He'll help you give you wise decisions. He'll increase your learning of himself and who he is. What he is not is a breaker of promises. A group saying that God's testing us. God's testing all of us. And one particular group comes out and says, well, God took away the promises from Israel and gave them to the church. You don't know your God. God doesn't break his promises. God is a God of love. God isn't a man that he should lie. But when one group says that, and they seem to have influenced quite a number of churches, a lot of churches have been influenced by these false doctrines, by these false teachings and misleadings. In Colossians 2, 6 through 23 helps us eliminate some of these false concepts. get to see a bigger picture, get to understand who our God is. Starting at verse 6, I says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Verse 8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Right there, starting at 8, and ending at 10. Now, there's two good numbers for you. We see that we know that Christ is God incarnate. Right there in verse 9, it says, for in him dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all in one package. Hallelujah. One man changed the outcome of all of history. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, in whom the angels worshipped in heaven. Now it says, man spoiled through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men. Tradition. Tradition keeps God from doing his work. Tradition holds back God from moving the way he would like to move among us. We say, well, we don't want to do it that way. That's not the way we've always done it. We want, no, nope. And that is why he comes down in verse 16 and says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of holy day or of the new moon or the Sabbath days. Remember, we're under the curse. We're under the law. And the law says that if we break any one of these 10 commandments, we are not going to be allowed into the entrance in the presence of God. Think of the 10 commandments as the teacher's grading points. And he doesn't grade on the curve, by the way. You break any one, you flunk. You need an A in all to pass. Think of it that way. Jesus not only gave an A, got an A on his report card by obeying every one of the 10 commandments, he took 2 commandments and made them even more difficult to say, look, you need me. So you need him. He made, if you look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery already. If you hate your brother, you've committed murder. In your heart, you've committed murder. It's spiritual. Who hasn't looked upon a woman? Who hasn't hated? See, he's made him. He, in other words, Jesus wasn't satisfied with just getting A's. He got an A++. You see, well, the commandments. How many of the commandments have you kept? Jews will try to tell you they've kept them all. No one can keep them all. Rome, we can't, none of us can keep them all. We can't keep them. That's why Jesus came, to take care of that for us. See, he wants to give us his A. He wants us to give us the passing grade so that we can be proud and walk in heaven feeling victorious. We are victorious over the world. We are victorious over the world because we walk in Christ. The world is out to destroy us and to kill us. It's turmoil. See, the center of this heptagon, you'll see this turmoil. And people are starting their weeks and they're ending up, they're frustrated, they're turmoil. They're killing themselves, they're shooting themselves, they're raping each other. The chaos. All because of one day neglected. One day. All because they didn't get to know that God is there to protect, to love, to nurture. He's called us his children. And as children, a father has his right to discipline his children. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. We have been given life. And who has given us this life? It is God's. It is his to take away. It is his to encourage, to lift up. It is his life. If you don't want him to have your life, but you expect to be in heaven, and I think you're delusional. You cannot have no relationship with God and then all of a sudden think when you get to heaven you're going to have relationship with God. No, he said he set aside one day a week that you could become in relationship with him. And he doesn't care if it's a Monday, a Tuesday, a Wednesday, a Thursday, a Friday. You spend one day in fellowship with other believers, growing, nurturing, helping each other out. You become not like Cain, am I my brother's keeper, but more like Abel, caring, concerned about others. Concern. See, Abel was concerned about God and his relationship to God. He offered up the sacrifice that was pleasing to God. He was the first one who had mastered and figured it out. God looked down on Abel's offering with respect. Who didn't look at Abel's offering with respect? Actually, it was the enemy. The enemy didn't respect Abel's offering. In fact, he was jealous. He was angry that God had favored Abel in this offering. And right away, he thought that this was the son who would crush his head. And well, it wasn't. And so he rose up within the
heart of Cain to attack his brother Abel out of fear.
Sin. Relationship cut off. We think of all of the children that Adam and Eve must have had before the fall. Because we know that when Cain gets married, he has his son Enoch, his firstborn son Enoch, and somewhere in time he's building a city for Enoch. God cursed the whole earth for the sake of man. See, it was Adam and Eve he told not to eat of the fruit in the midst of the garden. Told them not to eat of it. Just gave them that one rule, the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. Once they did that, it wasn't the fruit as much as the disobedience. Once the disobedience fell, then they realized that they had erred. They did wrong against God. He's holy, and it's hard to approach a holy God when you've done wrong. And that is why he sent his son, so that we can approach him, so we can see his forgiveness, and we can come in. See, when Jesus died on the cross, the temple's curtain was cut in two, rent in two. No more need for high priest. God was no longer hiding behind the curtain. Full access was given to all and everyone. The Holy Spirit came into every believer. We have a problem in the world today. We have tradition, doctrines, demons, and devils. The Bible says, well, the Bible teaches us and reveals to us that when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, he quoted the word of God against the enemy. And the enemy was pretty much had his hands tied. He couldn't refute the word of God. He could not refute what the word said, because the word was spoken of by God, and he cannot refute what God's word says. And so Jesus didn't deny him that he wasn't the principality and power of this world. But the heavens belong to God, and so does the earth and all that dwell within the earth. The enemy was just getting it for a loner. It's just a loner. It's to prove to the angels, can he create peace? Can he do peace without the Son of God? And the very fact is that he can't. He actually insulted God by building the very symbols of the battle of good and evil. That's what gives me this, by seeing those symbols. God wants to honor the one who sees the truth. The truth, what's the truth? The truth sets people free. In Daniel 8:12, we learn that the truth is cast to the ground where it practices and prospers. Truth is not a bad thing. It's a bad thing if you're a liar. It's a bad thing if you're deceiving people and misleading people. Then the truth you don't want to be shown, so you keep it hidden away. Certain group of people hid the word of God away and kept it away from the masses. And it's like, wow, what an invitation for demonic activity, huh? Nothing to fight the demons with. Hide the word of God away from people. Then the demons could just run freely and do whatever they wanted to do. Then bring in, you know, doctrines of demons. Bring in doctrines of idolatry. See, I asked this question and I never get the answers for it. No one's given me the answers, and I would really like to have the answers, because I'm putting this thing on hiatus. I'm putting it on hold. I'm not going nowhere with this. You see, it's because I have all these coincidences in my life. The number 5 follows me wherever I go, in sequences of 3, by the way. You know, house number I grew up in, the apartment I ended up renting at the end of the age, you know, the license plate that 5 just follow me everywhere. I can't get away from the sequences of 555, which adds to 15, which is a number for mercy. When you really think about it, 555 comes before 666. Now, is it a coincidence that it's followed me? Is it a coincidence that the first king? No, this is the thing. I've heard ministers state, and